Good morning and welcome to this, the seventh meeting of the Equalities and Human Rights Committee in 2017. Can I make the usual request that mobile phones are switched onto airplane mode or onto silent? We've received no apologies for the meeting this morning. We've got a full complement of colleagues. Moving very swiftly on to our main agenda item this morning, we have a ongoing inquiry on destitution, asylum and insecure immigration status. This is our first oral evidence. We have been to visit many of the projects and the organisations involved in this, so we're really keen to hear from some of the voices on the record today. With us this morning we have Fiona McLeod, who is the Senior Policy and Public Affairs Officer with the British Red Cross. We have Tam Baillie, the Commissioner for the Children and Young People in Scotland. Judith Robertson, Chair of the Scottish Human Rights Commission. Graeme O'Neill, who is the Policy Officer of the Scottish Refugee Council. And Jo Ozga, who is the Policy Worker for Scottish Women's Aid. Can I say good morning to you all, and thank you so much for coming to committee, and thank you so much for many of your organisations who have hosted us in our visits over the past few weeks, and we're looking forward to working with you on this topic, a very, very important topic. What I was going to do was allow you to open with maybe a minute or so of telling each one of you telling us what you're involved in right now, and then hopefully that's going to inspire lots of questions from us. I suspect it will. Jo, would you like to start?
Thank you very much, and thank you for inviting me to this meeting today. Scottish Women's Aid is a national organisation working to prevent domestic abuse in Scotland. We also are the umbrella organisation and represent the views of the network of women's aid groups working across Scotland who provide direct services, including refuges and support services to women and children. Our concern is obviously coming from our membership, women's aid groups working in different areas of Scotland who are unable to support or give access, refuge access to women with insecure immigration status, either because they have no recourse to public funds or because they are women from the European Union who have no access to housing benefit. So there's a real serious concern for our membership and obviously for ourselves about the risk that these women and their children face. They're largely then trapped in relationships that they're unable to leave, or if they do leave, they find that they're unable to get the support and accommodation that they thought that they would be entitled to, or that they've been told, say, by the police when they're called to a situation that they shouldn't be living in that situation, that there is, that that's not supposed to be happening, and women have a right to live free from violence. But then find when they're assessed by women's aid groups that actually they're not going to be able to accommodate them, or that they're unlikely to face a long and lengthy process of trying to access financial support. So our serious concern is about what is happening, the risk to women and children in Scotland at the moment.
Yeah, thanks very much, Jo. Graeme.
I'm Graeme O'Neill from the Scottish Refugee Council, and just to echo Jo, we're absolutely delighted to be here with you today, and we're delighted as well that you're conducting this inquiry. And we're delighted because, you know, we've worked for 30 years with people seeking and people granted refugee protection. And one of the things that struck us, particularly in the last 17 years, so since 2000, has been how destitution is built into the UK asylum process. It doesn't need to be like that, but we, in our experiences, it is like that at different stages of the process. And one of the most acute stages of the process is when people have been refused asylum and find themselves with no recourse to public funds, but nonetheless are still physically in Scotland or in Glasgow or wherever they've been dispersed to. And one of the things that we're really keen to, hopefully through this inquiry, talk about is a different approach to combating destitution within the UK, and how Scotland is well placed with the significant devolution of powers that it has to start considering doing that. Scottish Refugee Council has, and has for a number of years, worked with people seeking granted refugee protection, as I say. So currently we have a refugee integration service We also have a service that works with asylum-seeking families, and we're also partners within a multi-agency service, the Destitute Asylum Seeker Service, that works with people who are at risk of or are destitute in order to try and get people back in to access either UK or Scottish entitlements to support and lift them out of destitution. And obviously, we can hopefully talk about some of these issues later on today.
Thanks very much, Graham. Judith.
Good morning, and again, thank you for the invitation to give evidence this morning. Clearly, our interest from the Scottish Human Rights Commission's perspective is in the human rights framing of the issue within Scotland. As you are aware, there is a limit to our mandate, as immigration primarily is a reserved power. The principal focus, locus on immigration issues is that of the Equality and Human Rights Commission. However, because of the impact on Scottish public authorities in relation to this issue, we felt it was appropriate for us to bring that human rights perspective this morning, which is what I will be doing. And so I'll be framing the contribution I'll be making is really looking at destitution as a human rights issue, the implications of that for public authorities in Scotland, echoing some of the comments that have been made by all the panellists actually this morning in relation to the evidence I've seen. So we'll be supporting that in terms of the evidence we're giving.
Yeah, thanks very much, Judith. Tam, you'll have a particular perspective given your role as a Children's Commissioner, so we'd be keen to hear from you.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm very pleased to be here, and it's excellent that this is the inquiry's been prompted by the committee, because these are some of the most vulnerable people in our society, and by dint of that, some of the most vulnerable children. So that's my main interest. Most recently, we've been quite heavily involved in unaccompanied asylum-seeking children. But in this one, it looks as if we've got very variable practice, given some of the examples that have been given to the committee already. And there's a requirement, really, for us to be much more consistent and much more aware of our responsibilities to these children and their parents and carers. So that's really why I'm here. I was struck by one quote in the evidence, and it was when Janice Scott was quoting the Court of Appeal, and they referred to the impenetrable nature of the legislation. And I think that colours everybody's approach to it, because it is quite difficult sometimes to get our head around the kind of things that we should be aware of. But I think there's some other very helpful evidence that will come to light today, which hopefully the committee will be able to bring to a much wider audience.
There's a few committee members who have got specific topics that they'll pursue with each of you, as you can imagine. Fiona.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Fiona McLeod, and I work for the British Red Cross. I'll echo everyone else's thanks to the committee for looking at this issue and for inviting us here today to give evidence. The British Red Cross is an organisation which works with refugees and asylum seekers right across the UK. Last year across the UK, we supported over 30,000 asylum seekers and refugees. In Scotland, our offices are primarily based in Glasgow, and there we provide support, advice and practical assistance to refugees and asylum seekers, both within the system and as they reunite with their families later on when they have refugee status. Like Graham said, destitution is built into the asylum process, and it doesn't have to be that way. We're here to give evidence today on the impact that it has on our clients, and the belief that we think a different approach could be much more humanitarian and prevent the breach of rights for those individuals in that situation.
Thanks very much. Fiona, I'm going to go to our colleagues for questions, and Alec O'Hamilton's coming in first. He's got a particular issue that you'd like to pursue.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, everybody, and thank you very much for joining us today. I'd like to pick up on something Tam mentioned, which is in particular unaccompanied children seeking asylum, and I should declare an interest that before I came to the Scottish Parliament, I worked for Abelara, which works with the Scottish Refugee Council to deliver Scotland's guardianship service for unaccompanied asylum seekers. In England, since the Hillingdon judgment over a decade ago, children, unaccompanied children seeking asylum have been afforded at-risk status, which is slightly different than they are regarded here. And I know that while I was in the sector, there was a debate about how we could improve the sort of legislative status of children seeking asylum who are unaccompanied in this country, almost to the point of giving them looked after status, which obviously, given the Children and Young People Act of 2014, would entitle them to things like aftercare as well on attaining the age of 21. Can those panel members who have a particular interest in the field of unaccompanied children seeking asylum give us as a committee an idea of where we still need to move, building on the work of the Human Trafficking Act of last year, in terms of protecting the status or giving children in this position an enhanced protection in the eyes of the law?
Tam, do you want to start with you?
We've been quite heavily involved recently with unaccompanied asylum-seeking children, and I'll deal with that, but I do want to talk about children in circumstances of destitution. So unaccompanied asylum-seeking children has been... Scotland has responded positively within the confines of the legislation, because children who first of all are arriving in Kent are it's not easy to effect transfer for those children to Scotland, but there have been children who've come up under the Dubs Amendment, and I attended a meeting recently which was chaired by the First Minister to consider the Scottish response to that, and very heartened by the assurances given by Glasgow about the numbers of children that they were receiving and the looked after status of those children and all of the legislative responsibilities being honoured for those children. Now these are plans, but we certainly, I think people were reassured about the approach that's been taken to that group of children.
Just ask, because you said the looked after status, so are they are unaccompanied children in Scotland who are seeking asylum currently afforded Section 25 status now? So they are effectively in care when they are in this country?
Yeah, specifically for these additional children, there were assurances given that they would be looked after and that they would receive all of the new and pending responsibilities that the local authority would have to dispense to them in terms of the looked after status. So some of the detail is still to be worked out. I expect there to be more discussion on that. And I certainly was one of the people going into the meeting seeking those types of assurances.
So that's the kids that are coming here under the Dubs Amendment. But in terms of those who make their own way to Scottish points of entry and present and request asylum, are they given Section 25 status?
There's an issue about Section 25 versus Section 22, as you might be aware. My understanding is that that's still to be formally agreed. I would be pushing for Section 25 so that those children have got the full looked after status as every other child.
I think Graham wants to come in.
Yeah, just to echo Tam's comments, and the Legal Services Agency done some really great work about 2 years ago when about this issue about local authorities, variable practice across local authorities in Scotland, some providing support under Section 22, the Child in Need provisions in the Children Scotland Act 95, and some doing it as they should have been doing it and was good under Section 25. The First Minister has been very clear on this at the round table, and the legislation is very clear on this, that, you know, an unaccompanied child who doesn't have a parental or a customary caregiver from outside, physically in the UK, they are a looked after child up to the age of 18, and they should be treated as such in terms of assessment, review processes, decision making processes, and then also in terms of entitlements to after and continuing care in Scotland's pioneering Children and Young People Act from 2014. That's our position in relation to that status.
Sorry, just final question. If there is an inconsistency of application where some local authorities are still only granting children in need support under Section 22, is there something we as a parliament need to do more in terms of legislation to ensure that local authorities are applying their duties under Section 25 and making these children looked after?
Yes. Highlight it in your report and make sure that looked after status should be through Section 25. I think you may hear from Kirsty later on about that business of 22 versus 25. We're still not there yet, but it would be another useful lever for it to be highlighted through the report of this committee. Can I just jump back? I'm sorry for for continuing, but I want to really highlight about the plight of children who don't have the unaccompanied status, but who are part of these families who are destitute. And my reading of the evidence is that it's quite clear that these children could and should be getting support under Section 12. And that really is very important, because it's important for two reasons. One is that we need to make sure that local authorities or people who are responsible for providing service know that that's the case, and secondly, that we've got consistent practice in the application of that. And that, again, would be something that could be very usefully directed through the whatever report comes from the committee. And beyond that, we need to make sure that there are standards that people at local authority level, not just local authorities, but at local level, local provision, adhere to in terms of trying to provide decent services for people who are caught in these circumstances that are as a result of UK legislation, really. But we've got a responsibility at local level to respond to them.
Thank you.
One of the issues that I picked up from the Immigration Practitioners Group's evidence that they gave us is there's an issue between kids that are transferring between local authorities, whether they've got a status under an English law and they transfer to Scotland, and the issues that poses. And I seen Fiona trying to get in there, because I suspect that you'll answer my next question before I even ask it, and it is about how Section 12 has been used differently, not just by local authorities, but maybe by local offices. And that was one of the issues we picked up in the visit when we came to the British Red Cross that day.
Yes, so there's a couple of things I think that are relevant. One, just to pick up on a gap around unaccompanied children that the Red Cross has identified through our youth psychosocial support services. We are seeing some children who are dispersed through the UK asylum system, so they are age assessed in England and then dispersed through the UK asylum system as an adult, at which stage they sometimes present at our Red Cross offices in Glasgow and they dispute their age. Currently, they aren't entitled to the same level of support as someone who arrives and is recognised as a child legally, even though they may not have exhausted all legal means to challenge that age assessment. And sometimes they're not even fully aware of what the process of age assessment has been. So that was just a little gap around age-disputed young children. In relation to the work that we do with many women and families, I think that we have certainly seen a rising inconsistency in the application of care and support, specifically in the family context, where families have presented to social work who are destitute, requiring support and help, and we have had cases where those families have been told that the local authority has no duty to assist them as an individual, and that they would meet their duties to the child by taking that child into care and removing them from the family home. Some of our cases have been with very, very young children. In one case, the mother was still breastfeeding her child. Obviously, we would strongly argue that in these cases there was no protection concerns, and that it would have been hugely detrimental to remove that child from their home, and that Section 22 should be applied in conjunction to protect that family unit and protect those best interests of the child.
Yeah, we heard some of those stories face-to-face from some of the families we met that day, and it's something we have got very much on our radar in that sense. That's the last thing we need, is families being split up. I've got Mary wanting to come in next, and then Jeremy.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, and thank you all for the written evidence that you've submitted and for assisting us in the visits that we've done. I wonder if I could start, Graham, with you and some of the things that you talk about in the evidence that you've given, because what I'm keen to do, and I know the rest of the committee are really keen to do, is to produce a report that gives clear recommendations of what should be done. And I was struck by your written evidence when you talk about the freedom of information requests that you submitted to local authorities, particularly by the lack of response that you've had, but also the lack of awareness that they've had. So in very practical terms, Do you think compelling or requesting COSLA to update the guidance would make a real difference? And is there something else that could be done? And I'd be keen to hear from the other panel members in very practical terms what we can put in this report that will actually make a difference and help families.
Thank you. It's a very pertinent question. The updating of the COSLA guidance is a necessary, by no means sufficient condition. One of the things that we took from the responses to the Freedom of Information Act requests was that there was low knowledge of what technical terms like no recourse to public funds are. There was no practices in relation to human rights assessments. And these are essential bits of knowledge for a local authority to act lawfully. That is to say, to make sure that it's actually ensuring that when it makes a decision about whether to give somebody or not support under the relevant legislation, that it's doing so in a lawful manner, that it has evidence behind it, it's transparent to the decision-making process, and it's something that can be justified if challenged. In terms of practical measures, there's a clear need for, we think, the needs of individuals and families who are in these predicaments to be brought in to the various strategies and policies that we have in Scotland. We have a very good violence against women and girls strategy. We have a very good anti-trafficking and exploitation strategy. We have an excellent GovFEC framework. We have a lot of good stuff already. But this group of people have been sitting outside of that. Fabulous work that's been getting taken forward, and that needs to change, and it needs to change urgently. We have also a new Scots refugee integration strategy, which we would suggest is one of the most obvious vehicles to bring the needs of certainly asylum seekers within, the needs of refused asylum seekers who are at risk of destitution and experiencing destitution into the work of key statutory authorities across Scotland. So the key ones will be local authorities and health services, and it's going to be essential that that's done. So we need to have a role for awareness raising, we need to have a role for training in relation to no recourse to public funds, human rights assessments, child in need assessment tools to be refreshed. All of that stuff needs to be brought, because one of the things I think we need to step back on here when we're talking about destitution and people in relation to insecure immigration status is that Scotland is at a crossroads moment in relation to the numbers, the different groups, the geographical location of people who are seeking or granted refugee protection. We're seeing that, which is a very, Scotland should be and has been praised for it. It's a very good thing. But we need to make sure that we have a system in place to deal with that. And one of the most urgent areas we need to have a system in place to deal with that is that the local authorities, the other local statutory bodies within the areas that people who are at risk of or are in destitution are actually physically in, know who the people are, know what their legal statuses mean, and then are able and feel confident and able to be working with people in those situations because they've been trained, because they've got a clear awareness, because they have policies and procedures to follow. In England, we have a number of good policies and procedures to follow. We should have them in Scotland as well. And we just need to make sure that we move quickly to do that. And that's one of the practical recommendations that the committee needs to make, we think, is to say we need to have clear policies and procedures, clear awareness raising and training to make sure that this group of people who are at risk of or are in destitution actually get fair, practical access to services and protection.
Sorry, Mary.
In relation to COSLA, who should be involved in updating and making sure that the requirements and the regulations are up to date and are actually going to be fit for the purpose?
What we think needs to happen here is that we need to move seriously into a multi-agency approach in relation to the development of such guidance. Local authorities absolutely need to be at the heart of that, but so do health services, so do key NGOs such as British Red Cross, such as Scottish Refugee Council, such as Children and Young People's Commission and Scottish Human Rights Commission. We need to have, we need to have some of the key legal practitioners available as well. Now, I've mentioned a lot there. I probably wouldn't expand it too much beyond that, but what we need to have is a multi-agency approach, bringing the different key institutions and agencies round the table to share knowledge so that you actually have something that's really owned and something that also has a holistic perspective of the person. It looks at the health issues, it looks at the legal status issues, it looks if there's any child protection issues, it has them in mind as well. We need to, it's part of, you know, Scotland getting a response. We talk about a response gap we have in Scotland in relation to destitution, and we don't do it lightly. We think it's there, we think it's real, and we need to fill it. And one of the practical ways for us to do that is through awareness raising, training and guidance, but we need to develop such in an inclusive multi-agency manner.
Do you want to come in before the rest of the panel members come in?
Judith, I wanted to ask you something specifically. When we went on some of the visits, some of the inconsistency about social work practice. So you would have a family that would be destitute that would pitch up at a social work office and they would either be seen or not seen. But if they were seen, and a social work assessment would ensue, normal procedure. When I asked a question about the human rights assessment, many people said, well, that wasn't done until months later. Whereas I would see the two things having to run in tandem, almost the human rights assessment piggybacking on the top of that. Now, would it be a practical assessment, requirement that is done, that the two assessments take place together? And would that be something where the Scottish Human Rights Commission would come in and give advice on?
Certainly, in relation to the evidence that's been here, a human rights assessment is... I don't know if it's a statutory requirement in terms of actually doing an assessment, but certainly in terms of recommended good practice in relation to... determining what are the human rights implications of the decisions that are being made in front of them. So there are a number of factors which would be brought into play. Clearly, in legal terms, the implications of the Human Rights Act, principally Article 3 and Article 8, Article 3 being the right to freedom from inhuman and degrading treatment, Article 8, right to private family life. Those are the two kind of key things in relation to the Human Rights Act implications of decision making at an individual level. So I have to say, the lack of awareness and understanding of human rights implications of decision making is not just an issue in relation to destitution of asylum seekers and across this. That's a systemic issue across the piece. I would say probably it's the knowledge base is most strong when it comes to the rights of the child throughout social work and housing and other public authorities' practice. So the lack of using that human rights lens through which to make decisions is the reason we're talking about it today is because it is most acute because of the extreme nature of what's happening to people at the end of this line. But it's an issue right up the system, if that makes sense. So the gap is I don't want to impugn local authorities just in the basis of this issue. It's a systemic issue. However, the recommendation I think that Scottish Refugee Council have made around a human rights assessment is a really important one. And providing that human rights analysis and an understanding to local authority decision makers that's very doable. They should be doing that on their own. That's their job, that's their core duty. Because while the justiciable nature of the Human Rights Act means that that's their primary reason that they can be called to judicial review, for example, they have other international legal obligations around the right to adequate standard of living, which would then impact on the right to social security, the right to housing, and the right to social care and other right to health more broad. There are a range of human right issues which impact on the decisions that are being made. Now, while they can't at the moment, and this is one of the reasons that as the Scottish Human Rights Commission we are recommending economic, social, cultural rights are made justiciable in Scotland within the bounds of the parameters of Scots law and the devolved powers. This is an area where then you would be able to see much stronger recourse to using the courts when failures in the system happen and people do become destitute for whatever reason. At the moment, the Human Rights Act provides very high bars, very high thresholds that people have to cross. And that's one of the reasons destitution actually happens, is because the thresholds are so high, and they have these kind of quite arcane arguments about whether or not, from my perspective, whether or not somebody is meeting the terms of the difficulty, as opposed to saying destitution is a human rights issue. It shouldn't be allowed under, it isn't allowed actually under international law, and therefore that's what we should primarily be dealing with. Does that make sense?
I mean, I think it does. Joe, in relation to Mary's original question, I mean, all of the organisations we've got here are obviously talking about people who are seeking asylum and people who have got insecure immigration status. But on top of that, you've got people who are in that situation and then maybe in a domestic violence situation as well. So in relation to Mary's question, would you want to elaborate a wee bit?
I mean, I would agree with Graham's and the Scottish Refugee Council's recommendation about, you know, needing for a clear multi-agency approach to developing good guidance for local authorities and other public bodies. Because we know from women's aid groups working in different areas of Scotland, there's very different practice goes on in terms of assessments for, say, even for children under Section 12 or Section 22, or children, as Fiona said, being children can be taken into care for women who are experiencing domestic abuse and no support given to the mother. I think we would strongly support that recommendation that there needs to be much better guidance and training and awareness so to enable public bodies to be able to fulfil their duties to a much better extent than they are currently, yeah. and to recognise the risks that of not providing sort of emergency or crisis support is posing to women and children in Scotland, and what the likely outcome might be of not actually doing that, as opposed to saying that they can't do something. I think that's the situation that women's aid groups often come across. And they have difficulty challenging these decisions if there's nothing there really to back them up.
Mary.
Before Graham, you come back in, I just wanted to ask a further question because and other committee members to a certain extent do as well. I have a bit of an aversion sometimes towards guidance because I always have a concern that guidance becomes something that sits on a shelf and gets dusty. And I'm not saying nothing is done with it. It's perhaps read and acknowledged, but it's not a live document. So I think we need to be really careful when we're making recommendations that built into them is some way of putting on record that there needs to be some kind of reporting mechanism or data collection mechanism so that the guidance and the way it's used can be properly tracked and we can actually physically or tangibly see the benefits that this is giving us. Would you agree with that?
I would completely agree with that. A recent example would be the work that was done with the Human Trafficking and Exploitation Scotland Act and the duty to have a strategy against trafficking, Scotland's strategy against this human rights abuse. And deliberately there was a mechanism put into that act to report to the Parliament periodically, and that was precisely to make sure that there was some checking mechanism, some improvement mechanism, some scrutiny and accountability. This isn't the same type of territory because we're talking about a pretty severe violation, you know, people that don't have any, people who don't have life anymore, they have an existence. People that, you know, who are making survival decisions, which could basically mean being pretty ruthlessly and horrendously exploited in exchange for accommodation. So it's as serious as that, and therefore the response from our Parliament in Scotland and through this, we hope these recommendations will be commensurate with that. The one thing I just wanted to add, Mary, in terms of your question, in terms of practical measures, is we think there's an essential need for practically accessible advocacy for people who are at risk of destitution or experiencing destitution. I mentioned the Asylum Seeking Family Service, which Glasgow City Council funds to its credit, which we're very grateful for. Its funding is, you know, it's not long-term funding. But what that service does is it provides a holistic keyword approach, so it builds up trust and confidence with families. The Immigration Act 2016, when it starts to take effect later on this year, will increase the risk of destitution for families also greatly. And if those families don't have access to practical advocacy, then they may not be able to access the Home Office entitlements that they actually are entitled to. So, you know, it would be perverse, because what you would have is more destitution, including potentially of families, and not able in Scotland to access those families, be able to access UK support. Whereas if you had a preventive approach through the provision of what we know is needed, which is practically accessible advocacy services, then that will prevent costs and humanitarian harm later on down the line, but it will prevent the costs as well for Scottish public authorities such as health and local government, as well as NGOs also. So I just really stress the importance in terms of recommendations, and the need for practically accessible advocacy is essential. And there is no prospect of the Home Office providing advocacy for asylum seekers. They, from their contract from 2014, explicitly required any contractor, in this case it's currently Migrant Help, not to provide advocacy for asylum seekers, when we know that's precisely what so many people need, because you're completely new to the country. You know, you may not have the language, you don't have the cultural and social connections that we have here. You need somebody to help you, and you need to speak to somebody. You can't necessarily get that help through over the phone or through a call centre, which is the current model that the Home Office fund. So it was just, I think that's a really important practical recommendation.
Thank you. Fiona, I think you wanted to come in, then we'll go to Jeremy.
Yeah, just on two small points. I think that the guidance point's a valid point, but I think actually for the clients that we see, the process of actually undertaking an assessment where their human rights are taken into consideration, and it's a transparent and fair process where actually the local authority is making a concrete decision, that in conjunction with Graham's point about the practical advocacy can give the clients that we see and the clients that everyone else see an understanding both of why the decision's been made, but also a much more clearer route to challenge a decision. At the moment, sometimes assessments aren't fully done, you know, people are turned away practically at the door, and so that process, it's completely impenetrable for people to actually challenge social work and or challenge practice. So I do think that the process of having to conduct the assessment can help and give some control back to the clients themselves. Just to echo Graham's point about independent advocacy and the need for it, we also in our written submission argued that we felt that would be a key recommendation for the committee to consider. And I think it's important for groups that are at the end of process, as important for people at the start of the process, and actually at the start of the process, that independent advocacy could help them to engage more positively in the asylum system, thereby reducing their chances of destitution at a later state. And I'm sure Joel would also, not to put words in your mouth, but say that independent advocacy would be good for the group of women that you see with insecure immigration status.
Good morning, everybody, and thank you very much again for coming. A couple of questions. Before I say that, I should probably declare, at least for another 7 weeks, I'm a councillor here in Edinburgh City Council and have that interest. I want to fly a kite, which has just come to me as we've been talking. And that is, if I'm a council officer in Clackmannanshire or East Lothian or wherever, I'm going to presumably see very few individuals, so I just don't have that expertise. Presumably most of the people we're talking about here are in Glasgow. So is there a mechanism, or do you think there needs to be some kind of body which takes this away from local authorities and is a more of a national body? Because then we would get better practice across the whole of the 32 regions. Because it does seem to be slightly unfair for a council officer in a council that maybe has one every 2 years to have that expertise, and how do you think he or she would be able to deal with that?
Tom.
Yes. It's to do with this business of how legislation is implemented. So I share some of the reservations that Mary has in respect of guidance, we do have legislation that could and should be used. Simple as that. So we should be accommodating these children and families under Section 12 and providing for them, and we should be using Section 25 as opposed to Section 22 so that children who are unaccompanied have their looked after status. And
I mean, I can, but my point is, if I'm a council officer in an office somewhere that very rarely sees this type of work, I simply don't have that knowledge.
I understand the point, and we may be able to coordinate, for instance, the reception of children or families at national level, and certainly COSLA and the bodies that they've got linked to them can provide that coordination. But the bottom line is that they are going to be coming into local authority or local areas. And I think that what we should be doing is to make sure that it's as clear as we can make it about how we should be dealing with families who are destitute or children who are unaccompanied. Otherwise, you could be in danger of setting up another cumbersome structure when we've got the capacity at local level. I understand the point about lack of awareness and understanding the legislation. That's why when we are issuing how the legislation should be implemented, it should be as clear as possible. And right now, I think we're lacking some of that clarity. And by all means, we may look at having a legal requirement, for instance, for advocacy services for families in these circumstances, so that in fact we make sure that's their safeguard in terms of the implementation of the legislation. So, I mean, I'm speaking off the top of my head right now. My priority really is making sure that this happens at local level.
I wonder if I can also just, again, maybe ask Fiona or Graham on this. The feedback I've had as a local councillor is that the Syrian resettlement worked pretty well, that we did get that right across most local authorities. Are there lessons we can learn from that project that we can then take back and look at the bigger picture of why we got that right? Was that simply due to lots of money was thrown at it to make sure that we did get it right? Or was there fundamental principles of how practice took place, that we could then say, well, that worked there, let's apply it there?
I think that there was something more fundamental going on in terms of the early success of the Syrian relocation programme in Scotland. Part of the success has been that commensurate money has been put into that scheme. So it's in the first year, for an individual coming through the Syrian relocation scheme, it's about 8,500 that follows that person. For an asylum seeker, an adult who is dispersed to Glasgow, so the current contractor for the Home Office is Serco, as we know, 3,500 follows that person. So you have a very stark inequality, and the Home Affairs Committee at Westminster has articulated that very clearly in its report into asylum accommodation. And it published at the end of January this year. But the more fundamental issue is about the manner in which that programme was planned and delivered. It basically empowered Scottish institutions to do what they can do best, which is they know the country best, they know their populations best and their communities best, they know their services best, and then try to work in a joined-up way in relation to bringing the benefits of that joined-up approach to the new arrivals. In terms of the UK asylum system, we spent a lot of time in our written evidence reiterating the point that we've been making for a number of years about destitution being built into the asylum process, entry to the process, then as you're going through the process in terms of like chronic poverty support, denial of the right to work, etc. And then at the end of the process, which is obviously when people have that particularly acute risk of destitution, as Fiona and myself have said at the start, it doesn't need to be this way. We could have very good practical preventative approaches in place. We mentioned practical advocacy would be one of those. Clear understanding at the local level of rights and entitlements would be another one, with safeguards built around that to make sure that it was actually being implemented consistently and appropriately. So what we said also in our written evidence is we talked a bit about an intergovernmental agreement in relation to how all refugee and dispersal is done, so for asylum seekers, for unaccompanied children, etc. And what we were trying to get at there is back to the logic of what dispersal was when it was first designed in 2000, is that the primary relationship should be between two governments, the Scottish and UK government. And there was nothing political about that. That was just more a reflection of the facts of devolution, that most of the issues which relate to the reception, the competences that relate to the reception and integration of people being moved to Scotland, health, housing, social work, other aspects of local government, community planning, community cohesion, crime, if in terms of risks of exploitation, etc., they're all devolved to the Scottish Parliament. So there's a real clear logic in terms of having much greater autonomy through an intergovernmental agreement being given to Scotland to make dispersal work better, because that is kind of close to what happened with the Syrian, not exactly what happened, but it's close to what happened with the Syrian relocation programme. And if we were to learn the lessons of that success, then we could actually, you know, build in a much more inclusive, humane system in Scotland in relation, and one of the things that that would do, because it would provide things like practical advocacy, clear understanding of rights and entitlements, would prevent or lessen the risk of destitution. And destitution doesn't just, of course, have huge humanitarian harm, it has huge financial risk and legal risk for Scottish public authorities also. So we need to, in Scotland, I think, be speaking very clearly, and we would hope the committee would consider this, about saying that about the desirability because of the good sense of having an intergovernmental arrangement. It doesn't need to talk about devolution. It just needs to focus on very practical measures which reflect the devolution of competencies we have already within the UK in order to make sure that the good public services we have in Scotland can actually be brought to bear very clearly and humanely for people, amongst other things, who are at risk of destitution.
Just on that point, I think Joe wants to come in to
actually, add to that. If you don't mind, the earlier question that you posed about local authorities and perhaps lack of experience due to numbers being concentrated in the sort of Glasgow and Edinburgh areas, that's certainly not Women's Aid experience in terms of the women that go to Women's Aid services across different areas of Scotland. There are women who have no recourse to public funds or are destitute because they're EU migrants from, you know, the Highlands and downwards. So that, I think there are different local authorities have a relatively high experience of having to respond to that kind of issue from women experiencing violence. Maybe not so much directly from asylum seekers being dispersed to different areas of Scotland, but it's certainly an issue that local authorities need to have a much more consistent approach to and be able to respond to much more effectively. And I take the point about guidance, and we have a number of issues with guidance as well, but I think there is a possibility of looking at sharing experience and having a practitioners network that is multi-agency. And one of our recommendations is also that we need to be systemically gathering evidence about the numbers and issues of women and girls in Scotland who are experiencing violence and having a secure immigration status, because we don't actually know that at the moment. And I think that's a real gap in terms of the information that we have.
Absolutely. Judith.
I just wanted to add to that in terms of there being a positive duty on public authorities and the Scottish Government to take action to prevent destitution. That is no matter what the context or the environment in which that sits. And thinking of the lessons from the Syrian refugee process, one of the, I suspect, factors, although I bow to the Refugee Council's greater knowledge of the system process, was the leadership that was shown by the Scottish Government in actually facilitating that process and bringing together all the different actors and getting them into the room. What's being presented here is there is a route whereby we can positively prevent destitution. That is possible, even within the strictures of the legislation that is handed down to us, that we have no the Parliament has no power over, and therefore there is an absolute positive duty on the Parliament and the government to take action to put in place the steps that can make that you know, prevent that happening. And that multi-agency approach and bringing the local authorities into the room to heighten both the knowledge and understanding and sense of urgency that the changes in legislation coming through are going to generate for people right across the system, I think is a really important recommendation that could come from the committee, which is not necessarily reflected here already.
Excellent. We're, as you can see, we're running out of time, which is always invariably the case because we've always got really good evidence to hear. I've got a question from Willie Coffey. Willie.
Thank you very much, Convener. I just wanted to probe this issue about destitution being built in and effectively being created by the immigration process. It's, many of you have said it's really about human rights. It's about human rights. It's not about immigration, but it seems that the state is creating, in many ways, many circumstances, the problem that we have. Graham, in your submission to us, you were telling us that unless people have got particular vulnerabilities, they've got to travel to Croydon to access the asylum procedure. Now, for goodness sake, I mean, do you think, are we getting further away from the kind of scenario that you described a wee minute ago, where local authorities could deal with these issues much more robustly and properly locally? Are we getting further away from that scenario? Because I get the sense that you're giving us the same kind of message, but you're whistling in the wind a wee bit. Would that be fair?
That people used to be able to register at Glasgow and they changed that to Croydon, and the people who need to get to Croydon don't get any assistance to get there. So it's up to organisations like this or charities or friends in order to even just give them the bus fare to get there. So I think you would be keen to elaborate on that.
Yeah. You know, the Home Office is an extensive network across the UK of offices, which is good, one of which is in Scotland, one of which is Glasgow, and as a convener is correctly pinpointed, you know, people who arrive in the UK, and most people arrive in the UK to claim protection in-country as opposed to at port. The vast majority do, then have to go to Croydon. And the risks to people in that, you know, around the exploitation are significant. You know, we got people going into this twilight world where we don't really know how people get to Croydon to access the asylum procedure. Some people will do it through, you know, their own means. Some people will do it through, you know, charities such as ourselves. But other people, we don't know how that's going to happen. And we think that's unacceptable. But we also think it's quite senseless as well, given that the Home Office have a network of offices where people can access the procedure. Because what happens is people access the procedure at London or Croydon, and then shortly after they're dispersed to different parts, predominantly the northwest, northeast of England or Glasgow or some parts of Wales. So they're dispersed back again. And it's like, well, why don't you let people access the procedure where they are, have a mature enough system so that they can then be moved into their forms of support, if they're entitled to forms of support, while they're waiting for a decision on their claim. It gets worse for people who are looking to re-access the asylum procedure, because asylum claims are complex, and the evidence doesn't come in a neat box. You know, circumstances change in countries of origin, and often people, you know, can present what's called fresh evidence, which then constitutes fresh representations. And one of the things that we pointed to in a report is that statistics that show about 20% over the last 10 years or so of people who have been destitute because, amongst other things, have been refused asylum, have gained protection status through putting in fresh representations, a fresh claim. Now, from January 2015, the Home Office made it very difficult for people to re-access the asylum procedure. So people who have been refused asylum, looking to re-access the asylum procedure with fresh evidence. And the only place they can then do that is in Liverpool, unless exceptional circumstances are deemed to pertain, which is very, very rare. So what people then have is that same restriction that they had for Croydon. They're having to re-access the asylum procedure only in Liverpool, when they could have been dispersed to Glasgow, they could have been dispersed to Plymouth, they could have been dispersed somewhere very far away. And it's just the senselessness, aside from the inhumanity of this. And that's, there are two examples of why destitution is built into the asylum process. Because if people, you know, are having to be dependent in such ways in order to access a fundamental human right, then it may well be that they don't actually access that fundamental human right, that they're into situations of exploitation. And I would hope and expect that Police Scotland will talk about some of these issues in terms of the risks for, in terms of the vulnerabilities that come for this particular group of people who are at risk of or are experiencing destitution to exploitation, potentially also to organised crime. So, you know, again, going back to the severity of the issue we're talking about, that's as serious as we're talking about in terms of, you know, there's, it could be serious forms of exploitation that people are suffering, which are directly stemming from the way that the UK government, through the Home Office, have constructed access and reaccessing the asylum procedure.
Has it been worse, or any progress at all?
I think it's getting worse. You know, the removal of practical advocacy, the changes in terms of access to the asylum procedure and reaccessing the asylum procedure are three examples of, you know, how it's been getting worse. And as myself and Fiona and others have said, it really doesn't need to be this way. We could have a much more sensible and humane system.
Fiona, how does that work for young people who are maybe in that cusp of age assessment, you know, challenged age assessment or not, but still a very vulnerable young person on their own? How does that work? Do they need to make that journey on their own to Liverpool or Croydon?
If they're assessed as being an adult, even if they haven't exhausted all their legal means to challenge that decision, they would have to make that journey. Some of the challenges that we have is that it's at the point where they have lodged their claim that they are age assessed, and then they're dispersed into an adult system. So sometimes it's not that they've travelled down on their own, but I would imagine that many unaccompanied minors are making difficult and dangerous journeys.
Her reason, actually, Tam.
Assessed as being a child, then they would be provided for as a child within Scotland. But, I mean, all of this really should provide even more impetus to get it right when people are in Scotland. And so we're not whistling in the wind in terms of what we can do about it. We can make sure that we act in a humane way and that we don't have some of the shameful stories, quite frankly, that you've heard both out in your journeys and through the evidence. And there are things that we can do, and we can do it within our existing legislation. And if there's a message to come from the committee, it's to make sure that that clarity is there and that we get on and do that, and we don't add to the misery that these people have been put through because of some other matters which are out with our control. And of course, the committee may well want to make recommendations to urge the Scottish Government to take forward to the UK Government, but there's a clear focus for us getting it right more often and better within the framework that we've currently got.
We're taking much more evidence from other. We've got a second panel this morning, for instance, and then more panels coming up. And then we have the Cabinet Secretary coming to see us in a few weeks' time as well. We have extended an invitation to the UK Government. They have since declined that. We will keep trying, and hopefully they'll give us some written evidence in respect to our committee inquiry. But we're bang up against our time, and I know we've got a second panel, and I would suspect that members want to have a quick comfort break before we go into the second panel. So can I thank you all for your evidence this morning. Thank you so much for your written evidence, because that's going to help us along with your oral evidence this morning. We could have talked for hours on this, and you know that there's a lot of interest on the committee, and we're really keen to take forward some of the recommendations that you have suggested. So thank you so much, and we look forward to continuing the work. I'm going to go into a brief recess to suspend committee briefly to allow you to get a quick comfort break and to allow our second panel to come in. Welcome back to the Equality and Human Rights Committee. We move on to our second panel this morning on our inquiry on destitution and immigration and asylum and... mixed it all up. Anyway, our inquiry on destitution and asylum. This morning, we have our second panel with us this morning. We have Neil McKittrick, who is the Refugee Services Manager at the British Red Cross, Kirsty Thomson, who is the Co-Convenor of the Immigration Law Practitioners Group in Scotland, Robina Qureshi, who is Director of Positive Action in Housing, and we have Rani Danda, who is Positive Action in Housing too, and we have David Bradwell, who is a Refugee Coordinator with the Scottish Faith Action on Refugees. Now, you'll realise we have got a very tight timescale this morning. It's always the same on a Thursday morning, so we've got some specific, quite pointed questions to get on with. But what I wanted to do was to give you all a minute or so to tell us about the work that you're doing. And maybe, Robina, if you can handle positive action and housing, and we can get through the four of you very quickly. But David, do you want to start?
Sure, thank you very much. Thank you again for the invitation to speak with you this morning. Scottish Faith Action for Refugees is a multi-faith partnership project. We work with Scotland's main Christian, Muslim, Jewish and interfaith organisations to coordinate and advocate and support response for work with asylum seekers and refugees here in Scotland and internationally. I am Scottish Faith Action for Refugees with a part-time colleague, so my work is as a national coordinator, but supporting local congregations all over the country. So I think that's my
point. Thank you very much. David, Robina.
My name is Robina Qureshi. I'm a Director of Positive Action in Housing. The work that we do, we're a refugee migrant homelessness charity that began in 1995. Primarily, the work that we've been doing in relation to destitution is to do with proactive casework, humanitarian support in the form of online crisis grants, which we are kind of fast developing, and also a kind of flagship project, which is the Room for Refugees refugee hosting programme, which works in partnership with 214 casework organisations across Scotland and the rest of the UK to basically accommodate people from refugee backgrounds who find themselves destitute at some point in the asylum process into people's homes. So it builds human bonds between people, long-lasting bonds, and we've seen life-transforming impacts. The online crisis grants is, as I understand it, the biggest grant giving out destitution grants in Scotland at present. This financial year that's about to end, we're giving out about 45,000. And next year it will go between 45 to about 55,000, unless other crisis situations intervene. And we do give crisis grants out to the British Red Cross clients that are referred to us for hosting, as well as humanitarian support.
Thanks very much, Robina. We heard in our evidence, we visited a number of projects, and we heard in our evidence of the actual practical help that Positive Action, every single person we spoke to, sang your praises. So, and you know, it was very heartening to hear that work from the people who were receiving it. Kirsty.
Thank you very much for inviting me here today. I'm a lawyer with 10 years' experience in the asylum and immigration sector, and indeed have been involved with some of the legal opinions mentioned in the first session around about children and women. However, I'm here today representing ILPA, which is a charity and a membership organisation largely comprised of immigration lawyers, advocates and barristers. I co-convene our Scottish committee, and I'm here to put forward the concerns that our members have in terms of what the committee is looking at. The first session, it merely concentrated on some of the issues and problems that we're having with the current system, and that's with the current centralised asylum support framework, where local authority support can pick up the residual cases where not to do so would be a breach of human rights or child rights legislation. Unfortunately, our submissions look at the prism of the Immigration Act, and when its provisions come in force, what that will then look like, because the situation that we have will become worse. What that Act does is it restricts those who are able to access the centralised asylum support structure. It also restricts those who may be able to access the kind of local authority structure of support, whilst recognising that that's obviously going to create categories of people who may be destitute. It has put in place a Home Office regulated local authority support system, which will provide support to migrant families and also some children who will be excluded from leaving care provisions. We're obviously concerned that that is going to increase problems with destitution. It's bringing in more layers of complexity, potentially more limited assessments, because it's been done through the prism of the Home Office regulating what local authorities should do. And really, with the current system, there are already kind of concerns about, well, how does that relate to human rights legislation, children's rights legislation? That's going to continue and be magnified in the future.
Yeah, thanks very much, Kirsty. Neil, I should have said that you're the British Red Cross in Northern Ireland.
Correct, yes. So thank you very much for inviting me along today. I'm the manager of refugee support for the Red Cross in Northern Ireland. And in my 10 years with the organisation, we have looked quite a lot at Scotland and some of the progress and proactive work you have done, particularly around areas of integration. But one area we have advanced in Northern Ireland has been destitution. And the Red Cross administer the Northern Ireland Government Crisis Fund that specifically tackles destitution across Northern Ireland. This crisis fund provides small amounts of cash to the most vulnerable in our society, with the view to them skipping or jumping destitution or mitigating the worst effects of destitution. And this has been a significant game changer for people who are destitute in Northern Ireland, as well as providing the tangible resource. It also gathers evidence and allows us to understand what causes destitution and what we can do practically to address that. So in your first session, you spoke quite a lot about some practical things you could do, clear, concise recommendations. And I would hope that this would be one of them. And I'm happy to answer any questions you may have on any aspect of that.
Yeah. Just before I open out to my colleagues, Neil, I want to ask you something specifically that came up earlier about people having to report to Croydon or Liverpool. If you present in Northern Ireland, do you have to report to Croydon or Liverpool?
No, so Northern Ireland is not a dispersal area for asylum seekers, so if you claim asylum in Northern Ireland, you can stay in Northern Ireland. We do not receive people through the dispersal mechanism from Croydon, but once in Northern Ireland, you do not need to go to Croydon or Liverpool. That can be done in Belfast.
Okay. That's interesting. Thank you so much. Alex Cole-Hamill.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. I'd like to pick up on a number of things that Kirsty covered in your opening remarks. Thank you for those. But also something that we discussed in the previous panel, and that is the status of unaccompanied children who are seeking asylum in this country. It's clear from the responses from our earlier panellists that the legislation is actually pretty clear in Scotland that if a child presents and at a point of entry in Scotland and asks for asylum, and they should be treated as looked after children by the local authority in which they come to settle, and that they should have a track, therefore, Section 25 status under the terms of the 1995 Children's Act. However, what alarmed me quite severely in that panel session was the application of that legal basis is not consistent in every local authority in Scotland, despite it being a legal duty for them to afford them that status of being looked after, and with it all of the new kind of benefits that status enjoys after the Children and Young People Act of 2014, continuing care, aftercare services, the rest of it. Can the panel give me their reflection as to whether that is an accurate picture as to what's going on in Scotland and what they believe needs to happen so that local authorities consistently apply their duty in respect of the status of children seeking asylum?
Kirsty, can I ask you to come in on that, on the legal aspect? And then Robina, can I ask you to come in after Kirsty on the actual experience of young people when they come to you in your service, Kirsty?
Yes, I would agree completely with the comments that you have made. The duty, the legislation is clear. Any unaccompanied asylum-seeking child that arrives in Scotland, regardless of their age, should be looked after and accommodated under Section 25. And a legal opinion by Janice Scott MQC made that clear. So the problem is not with the legislation, but with its implementation and practice, and particularly with its implementation around about children who present when they're 16 and over. And often that doesn't arise as a problem until these children start to seek obligations under leave and care provisions that you've mentioned. So yes, the legislation is clear, but there are issues still with the implementation.
Robina, you tell us about some of the young people that you have faced over the years.
In terms of when, are you talking about families when they present?
Yeah.
In terms of when a family finds themselves destitute, before you could rely on the local authority to take care of that family and there was no issue. So I'm just referring to what's on the ground happening in our experience, and we've been doing this for 13 years. We've been able to kind of track what's going on. And I think, before, on the ground, what would happen is we could safely, as a charity, push the issue back of destitution into the hands of the local authority, because we do not want, although we have this crisis grants and hosting programme, this is not what we set out to do, but it's something that we had to do to alleviate the problem of destitution. And before, you could safely assume that the local authority, once pressed a little, would take the family and accommodate them. What's happening recently, in the last year, possibly year and a half, is that's not going to happen. Certainly not in Glasgow, it's not happening. So what happens is the family are presented, let's say the British Red Cross, who refer to us, families who have to be hosted through our refugee hosts. They'll go to the local authority and say the family are homeless, they're destitute, they need assistance until they can gather the evidence to submit their fresh claim or judicial review or whatever it is that they're doing in terms of their asylum case. And the local authority or the social worker will turn around, and that's what we're seeing recently, we'll take the child and we'll accommodate the child, but we will not be accommodating the parents. What they're saying is we'll take the children away from otherwise loving, responsible parents. The parents can't take that, and what ends up happening is they go underground, and therefore the child is placed in further vulnerability, and you don't get to know whether there are issues that they could get support with. And when it's presented at our door from the British Red Cross or within our own organisation, when we get families, what we have to really consider is the level of fear that the families feel regarding the social work, that they don't want to go back to the social worker. The social worker will take our children away, or will take my baby away. And we've been involved in cases where we're trying to make sure that the children are not being separated. So we then have to do what we don't want to do, which is turn to refugee hosts, volunteers, families, and say, would you take in this family? And that's what's happening at the moment in Glasgow.
Yeah. Alex.
I'd just like to ask Kirsty a little bit further in terms of when we talked about issues with the implementation. Is that there are certain local authorities, I'm not asking you to name them, but local authorities that are consistently not applying Section 25 status to young people who present, or is it just depends on the kind of social worker that young person encounters, or what are the issues that we're seeing with implementation of that duty that local authorities have?
Okay. From our members' perspective, I think there are a number of factors that come together. I would say a couple of years ago, there were certain local authorities who chose to apply Section 22, maybe say over Section 25. But I would say that has improved. But I would say that there is still a lack of awareness out there, a lack of confidence in terms of how to apply the right legislation when faced with a lone child seeking asylum, what that actually then means down the line when they're 18, when they're 19. So I think there's a lack of consistency, a lack of a clarity in terms of the legislation and what that actually means in practice, and a lack of awareness across the board about how to apply that. And also on top of that, you know, you can provide legal opinions and reports, which was done a couple of years ago, but you still require the sector and all sections of the sector to hold local authorities to account to make sure that all children are still being supported under Section 25. And for that, you need specialist legal service providers, specialist advocacy services. It's the same for what Robina was saying when families are being turned away. I mean, those families shouldn't under the current system. The legislation is, again, clear. So when it's not happening in practice, there's a whole host of things that come together. And one of the things is, you know, somebody needs to get in there with that family and say, the legislation is clear on this, it is not being implemented, and we're going to hold you to account.
So I'm sure I speak for all of my colleagues here when I say that we as a committee would be keen to take some action to address that. And if we were to do so in terms of tackling that lack of awareness, to whom should we direct our correspondence? Should we be writing to directors of social work in every local authority or the chief executive of every local authority? I mean, we're looking for your guidance here because I'm sure we would all want to have some output from this meeting.
My understanding was that the... And again, kind of coming from the Janice Scott legal opinion and the report and some of the freedom of information requests that were done around this issue a couple of years ago, that it had been taken up within the government and that some kind of guidance was to be prepared clarifying the situation, and that was to be distributed to all of the relevant individuals that you have mentioned. I'm not sure of the status of that, so there may be a point there to follow up on that. But my understanding was that there were, you know, things were in motion that might address some of the points that you made.
Thank you.
That's yeah, we'll think the committee would chase that up with no qualms at all. Mary.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. You'll have heard from the previous evidence session the question that I asked panel members about recommendations that will make a practical and tangible difference. And you'll have heard there was wide agreement that there needs to be updated guidance to local authorities, there needs to be a multi-agency approach, there needs to be more data collection and better access to advocacy services. So I'd be interested in hearing your views. Now, you may agree with everything that's been suggested in the earlier session, or there may be something else that you could suggest that would make a practical difference. But I wonder if I could start with Neil, because I was particularly interested in the brief description you gave us of the crisis fund in Northern Ireland. And I appreciate we are fairly short of time this morning, so you may not be able to go into a huge amount of detail of how that operates, but that would seem to me something quite practical that could be established here. So could you give me a bit of background into the practicalities of how that works and how you measure the success of that?
Yeah, absolutely. So it came about in an incident in Northern Ireland when a lady lost her leg to frostbite because she was sleeping in a doorway because she was destitute. And there was a campaign as to what can we practically do to support people who are facing this day and daily across Northern Ireland and equally across Scotland. So what we did was the Northern Ireland government came up with a pot of money and a pilot project, and they appointed the Red Cross. Red Cross are used to doing destitution support across the UK. We took the money on board, developed guidelines to support people, and then used 13 projects across Northern Ireland, geographically spread, who could access, people could come to access this small amounts of money. And the idea was that the partners to this project were people who already provide support to minority ethnics or asylum seekers, so likes of ourselves. So people come into us and ask, you know, I have to put in a fresh claim, or my benefits haven't come through, or something's been sent to the wrong address, or all the practical issues that can lead to temporary destitution, or I'm refused. What we would do would be we would look to tackle the cause of what that destitution is. What this money does is provide an opportunity for people to jump or avoid the homelessness, the starvation, all the things that are impacted by whatever that cause of destitution is. So we've run it over a number of years now, and the stats for last year, we have £54,000. That led to 1,511 claims, and that was 564 people, not including their dependents. And the sort of stuff you can gather data that nobody else across the UK has in destitution. So, for example, 31% of the people who accessed the fund were aged 31 to 40, and the average age was 35. So, there's some, you know, the average age for people who are destitute is about 35 years. There's something we didn't previously know.
the time in Northern Ireland, 14% of people accessing the fund had been in Northern Ireland for less than 2 years. So you would imagine the majority of people would be destitute when they don't know the system, they don't have networks, they don't have friends. Yet 18% of people who access the fund have been in Northern Ireland longer than 5 years. I've been working in this sector for years. That's not something that I knew before this information was available. And key, only 51% of the people only made one claim, and 46% of the people claimed less than £50 from the fund. So this is very, very small amounts of money, but they're having a major impact. So that £50, for example, maybe one of our key partners in this are Women's Aid. So if somebody comes in late in an afternoon somewhere, this can provide hostel accommodation over a weekend while statutory contacts are made. It allows people to, when somebody comes into you and they're destitute, you deal with their direct issues. I'm homeless. You have to try and source that. It takes time. This money can easily address that issue, and the experts who deal with destitution can go about resolving the situation. So all the groups reported that they were able to concentrate on what they're good at and not spend all day phoning charities or phoning faith groups to try and access support. So that's the strength that it has. But what it has done more than that is allow us to gather that data, but it allows us to identify themes on destitution. So one of the main areas is the transition period between somebody getting refugee status. So becoming transition from asylum seeker to refugee, there's a lot of destitution in there because the 28 days support that's provided is not long enough, and I'm sure you've heard that in your evidence. Refused asylum seekers are obviously crucial. A number of people who have been helped by the fund who were refused have then went on to get status later on. So, you know, again, this money was able to help them through that period. Refugee family reunion. So families who arrive, maybe there's one sponsor here, a parent, the rest of the family come over, they have to wait for benefits for that family. They have to transition from their support into family support, and they will be temporarily destitute. Domestic violence is a key issue. So you heard earlier from Women's Aid. People who are destitute stay in relationships in order to have a roof above their head. This money allows people to break from that relationship and to get some practical support while the core issue of the domestic violence is addressed. I could go on and on with multiple examples. The key point that I want to get across is we now have this. So we convene working groups to look at these issues. So a practical issue, a lady who is in the asylum system who's been refused and is pregnant can access Section 4 support after 34 weeks. But if they're pregnant up at 26 weeks, what do they do until they get to 34 weeks? The crisis fund will provide during that gap until the person can access the state support. So we're actually overwhelmed with things we can do. We now need to just try and prioritise these things. From what I've heard this morning, you don't yet have this level of information. So a small amount of money initially will definitely help people. People today who need money will be helped. But more than that, you will start to gather this data that will allow you to address and tackle the problems through your working groups and through policy and all those sorts of things. So it's mutually beneficial across a whole range of sectors and really understanding what the issue of destitution is.
David, you wanted to come in and then I can bring Robina in.
Thank you very much. I think following the earlier panel, the additional group that might be involved in training or guidance or awareness would be the civil society voluntary organisations. When preparing the evidence for today, working with some of the church clergy who work with asylum seekers in their congregations as members, the lack of really any understanding about how the systems of immigration work, how access to support, and actually I think for many people their church family or their friends might be an equally useful point of where do you discuss, how do you access services, how do you get your rights articulated and advocated for. So I'm thinking about that. And then perhaps a question for the Cabinet Secretary, if she comes, the development of the second stage of the new Scots refugee integration strategy, which I understand is now being developed, and actually whether something around training and advocacy for local authorities, statutory providers, and civil society groups could be included as an element in the development of this. But something new that I want to suggest is we've done a bit of Finding out about the situation that the churches and asylum sector in the Netherlands have been engaging in over the last 4 or 5 years with regard to the provision of emergency accommodation for refused asylum seekers, irregular migrants, and that it's been initiated there as a kind of social movement rather than as initially a legislative or human rights approach. So they've talked about the Bed, Bath and Bread campaign, which has brought together a whole range of different organisations to try and bring about a greater awareness in public knowledge and public life about the situation facing people in this situation and how people can help. Now, eventually, the Conference of European Churches, which is a European-wide umbrella group, took the Dutch government to the European Committee on Social Rights because they found that by not providing sufficient support for people in this situation, they were in breach of their European Social Charter obligations. Now, the Church of Scotland is a member of the Conference of European Churches, so we're really interested to know how this case had proceeded, that the complaint against the Dutch government was successful. So now, in the Netherlands, municipalities are required to support the provision of emergency shelters for Bed, Bath and Bread, and that also these places are centres where the irregular migrants can get access to mental health support and discussion about either a reapplication or discussion about return to country of origin. It seems like a much more humane way, much more a better way, that there's then attempts to eliminate street homelessness because of irregular migration and asylum. But it's delivered often through shelters run in church halls, and the involvement and support of voluntary groups in making this happen is also really important. So it's not so much a thing for legislation, for Parliament, but for the wider sense of political and civic leadership. So whether it's a matter for motions and debates or having some things discussed in integration strategies or so.
And collective responsibility of an issue.
But it's been very politically controversial, and you know, different political parties in the Netherlands, as we just yesterday, it's been very topical. And I think I also think though that the scale in the Netherlands of the number of people in the situation is likely to be much higher than Scotland, partly because it's much harder for anyone to get to the UK through the asylum or immigration route. So there's maybe there's something to learn, but also the scale of the situation for us is perhaps easier to respond to at this age, but also of course working with Positive Action and the other fantastic work that goes on in terms of getting people to individuals, private citizens, to step up and respond in a way. So it's to match the legislative framework, also to rely on philanthropy and charity and goodwill.
Okay, thank you.
Robina, do you want to come in at that point?
Yeah. I didn't hear. We were on the train from Glasgow to Edinburgh, so we didn't hear the panel. But I'm feeling like our organisation is, I'm a bit confused because our organisation seems to be coming across as a bit invisible in the paper that was submitted by the British Red Cross. On the one hand, we have a crisis grant system which matches what's happening in Northern Ireland, and yet zero reference has been made by the British Red Cross, who applies to our organisation for crisis grants for their clients, which we are happy to do, and which we're now rolling out, and we spent the money on the IT to do it, to distribute £50,000 minimum in the new financial year 2017-18 in crisis grants to people who are destitute. Not only that, we have considerable networks and resources to make that happen and have direct contact with the caseworkers as well as the people who are affected. So I would have liked to have seen some recognition from Neil and the British Red Cross that they actually take crisis grants from us, but zero mention, and now we're pushing this thing, which is fine. But I think we shouldn't detract from the programme that we have right now, which is Scotland has pioneered a refugee hosting programme in 2002, which others across England, I think Scotland should be proud of it, but not only proud of it, promote it. Because I'd like to hear the Scottish Parliament, I mean, I appreciate, I know that Christina knows about her work, but and you as chair, sorry, but At the same time, I think the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government should give recognition to that, but we sit silent and get on with the work, which is what we're quite happy to do, but not for it to be detracted from and said, by the way, that fund that you rely on individual donors to contribute to and to keep full in order to be able to give out crisis grants is now going to be administered by, let's say, the Scottish Government, which I'm not against, but what do donors then think? The problem solved, and therefore we don't need to assist. But with due respect, a crisis grant which the Red Cross in Northern Ireland is giving is between £1 and £50. Believe me, on our experience of the last 10 years of dealing with crisis grants and getting it to this level, where it's now an online crisis grant and caseworkers, 216 casework organisations are now affiliated. Every refugee aid organisation is now making referrals. Lots of departments of the British Red Cross are applying for those grants, including the London-based Refugee Council and the Scottish Refugee Council. This is not a small network. And therefore, that should be supported rather than detracted from. And therefore, government should step in with us to be able to kind of shore it up and give us the support. We strongly welcome it. But I think Scotland should be promoting it rather than, well, that's not necessary, because the danger is that the people who are most vulnerable will not be reached. And we have that contact. And between £1 and £50 may put somebody in a hostel for a weekend. It will not sustain them in the time that they need in order to gather the fresh evidence or prepare the judicial review or find a decent lawyer. And then to try to achieve the stability that they need long term, so that eventually they get leave to remain or find their place in life and can get a job, study and become productive taxpayers of tomorrow, unlike which is the British government's approach is leave them destitute, let them languish in the asylum process for years on end. Theresa May presided as Home Secretary over 100,000 letters that were stuck in an office in Liverpool or Croydon, and nobody opened those letters. They were recorded delivery, secured registered post letters. And she presided over that, and that backlog still remains. So we're stuck with that. And we also have a residual destitution problem of refugees. We use the word refugees. We're not going to use the word migrants because we think it insults what's happening to refugees. The refugees that are coming here to try and claim some form of stability and resettle their lives can get the assistance that they need through the hosting network. And we see that by putting that patchwork programme in place, we're developing rapidly the expertise, and I would invite you to come along and see what we're doing. I mean, really, it would kind of blow your mind, you know, for want of a better phrase, if you like.
We were very keen, Robina, to have positive action at the committee, and we've got about 100 pieces of written evidence, I think, in total, and about 25% of those are from asylum seekers themselves, and many of them mention your service as that lifeline and that lifesaver. So we did want to have you here along with the other organisations, because as David put it and others have put it, we don't do this by just government directive. We do it by ensuring that everybody works together in order to provide a service. And I did want to shine a spotlight on, I know the Destitution project, I've been involved with it for before I was a politician, so I know it well, and it was a good opportunity to bring you along and get your evidence on the record and to use that.
Sorry, with due respect, Chair, but I would appreciate it if the British Red Cross would actually recognise that. They're a big organisation, we're a small charity doing a big thing, and that needs to be recognised, not detracted from.
Well, we've got recommendations to make as part of our inquiry, so let's get on with some of that right now, and we can take that forward. Jeremy.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning again to everybody here. I suppose maybe just following up from what I was talking with the first panel, maybe first to David and then to Kirsty, if that's okay. David, obviously you've got a national experience, and I suppose a lot of us focusing on Glasgow because that is where the majority of the work is being done. What experience do you have from across other parts of Scotland of working, not working, and how church is involved in that? And then my second question back to Kirsty is, from a legal perspective, having now developed my thinking even in the last 15 minutes, would it help to have a cluster of councils coming together? So rather than having to go to, say, Edinburgh City Council or West Lothian Council, you came to maybe the old Lothian Regional, and where you would have that expertise in a cluster, and that could happen across Scotland. I just wonder what your view on that is. But David, maybe first of all, in regard to other things outside Glasgow, positive, negative?
I think, if I can start with Glasgow, I think because of the experience of asylum dispersal, Glasgow faith groups have got a phenomenally better experience of working around interfaith, intercultural dialogue, tackling racism, which many parts of the rest of the country could really learn from. I think also the just going by numbers, the number of people who seek asylum in Glasgow as the dispersal programme, and also as part of the other refugee resettlement programmes, so the Syrian resettlement, for instance, Glasgow has many more than other local authorities. And so there's a degree of can that experience be shared, but also from when working with destitute asylum seekers or people in this situation, are there things that churches and faith groups in other parts of Scotland can do to support congregations in the city, especially because in the dispersal areas are often the more deprived parts of Glasgow. So if a minister has got a benevolent fund, they might not have a lot of money that they could give to people who need 10 or 20 or 50 quid, but actually more affluent areas or churches that have got more resource could maybe support it. So one of the things that I try and do is encourage groups out with Glasgow to think of this issue as a national priority, not just an issue for Glasgow congregations. Some of the positive things that are happening in other parts of the country are really, in my experience, relating to the Syrian resettlement programme, just because this is what's new and what people are engaging with. But perhaps the lessons to be learned for this are positive collaboration between different sectors, and it's a repeat of what we said before. If the local authority and the churches and the mosques and the fire and rescue service and the police and the schools and the GP practices are all working together and discussing positive work, then it's sharing ideas and information. So it works when all of the sectors want to participate and discuss and share ideas and see that the outcome for the community and for the new arrivals is better by working together. And again, drawing on the Glasgow experience of the integration networks and the work specifically of GLADAN, the Glasgow Asylum Destitution Network, which is this a group of organisations often working on a voluntary basis, local churches and so on, coming together every couple of months to share news about changes in law, about practice, about how asylum dispersal might be taking place across the city. It's the sharing of information which is really, really important. And so it doesn't work when local church groups want to set up their own project and not engage with what the local authority is doing, or if the local authority wants to manage it all by themselves and not engage with. So it's, for me, yes, it's about communication and networking is what makes the real difference.
Yeah, I think going forward as well, what you've got to remember is the success of Syrian resettlement, and it's true with us and across the UK, you have people, including people from Syria, who are destitute through the normal asylum mechanism, and they're looking very much at Syrian resettlement and saying, well, I'm from Aleppo, the same as, you know, and these people meet at events and gather, and you know, one person is starting a new life, they feel very supportive via LinkedIn, the multi-agency support, and then you have somebody from maybe the exact street, a similar location, and they don't have the ability to, they feel destitute, they're homeless, they're hungry. So that juxtaposition between people is unsettling for everybody who kind of works in the sector. So it's something that we must keep an eye on as certain resettlement progresses over the next sort of 4 or 5 years.
Kirsty, do you want to come in the second part of Jeremy's question?
Yes. So in response to the proposal of a cluster of councils together, I'm very aware I'm here representing ILPAN. I have to put forward their position, and they won't have a position on this. So I can't comment in my role about that. However, what I would say in relation to that is that, as an individual, is that the legislation is quite clear in terms of where people are resident. It's that local authority who is responsible, and indeed the Immigration Act creates a whole scheme for the transfer of certain children from one area to another, and it's a complete transfer of responsibility. But certainly from our members' perspectives, we are struggling with some of the same questions in terms of where we have increased dispersal or increased children, refugees, families living in other areas of the country, and yet our expertise, our legal expertise, is contained within the Central Belt. What do we do there? What our roles and responsibilities and trying to share that expertise, because, you know, shuttling someone up and down is maybe an intermediate situation, but it's not a long-term situation. So for us, and in terms of our members, it is really about how do we, you know, if dispersal is going to happen and we need that knowledge and awareness within the legal community in other areas, what can we do as a legal community in order to facilitate that, but what can also the government do to facilitate that sharing of knowledge and expertise?
Thank you.
That might be actually where I can bring Rani in. Rani, I know your role at Positive Action is in research, and one of the things that Neil had said in his initial opening remarks was about data and how you can use data. I was wondering whether there's any connection with maybe the work that you do for Positive Action, and whether that connects to any of the work that anybody else does.
Well, I've just been listening to all the speakers as well, and I think the data is there, it is available, but what is not, as the speakers were also identifying, there's not a kind of uniform approach by the different city councils in Scotland. Although the legislation is there, it's not being, it's in implementation. Now, often there's it could be unwittingly, they don't know how to implement it, or whether it's deliberate as well. You know, this is very much open, but what is needed is from the Scottish Government guidance. But that guidance needs to come from the ground, from the organisations like ourselves, who have got experience of working with the city councils, and you know, we're very aware of what comes in the way and what works and what doesn't work. So it really needs like a type of a working group to advise the Scottish Government, and then to follow it through, not to leave it, because it's actually an implementation and working with each local authority to ensure that it is being implemented in the correct manner. And it takes, you know, it's not a one-off thing. It really needs a political will there, and it would need like a few years kind of constant work onto it.
Robina, you wanted to come back in?
Just regarding the prospect of dispersal to other local authorities outside Glasgow, we anticipate that will happen. I think most people kind of accept that is going to happen. We have the network in terms of, we anticipate destitution getting worse as a result of that, plus also to do with the Immigration Act as well. But in terms of the dispersal, we actually have refugee hosts in almost every part of Scotland to be able to take people in, and I'd be very happy for you to be kind of see where people are based. It's not to say that that is a solution, because it's not a solution to have to turn to individuals, private individuals, to resolve what should be a kind of a response of local authorities or the government to make sure people are not left destitute. The reality is that people are being made destitute, and we have this combination of online crisis grants that we spent a lot of money and IT developing, and also in terms of the refugee hosting programme. The networks are there, the resources are considerable when you factor in the voluntary effort and the level of pastoral support that can be offered as well, which has effectively resulted in people's lives being turned around as well. That was all.
I think we will come back to talk to you about that in the future. I've got a final question, because nobody else has indicated, from Willie.
Very much, Convener. We heard from the previous panel that destitution is basically effectively being created by the UK government through its Immigration Act, and it's getting worse. I'm interested in where we stand in terms of international law here. If a state creates circumstances that causes or creates destitution amongst its citizens or people applying for citizenship, where do we stand in terms of international law, and have there been any cases brought so far to try to test this? And I mean,
yes, I mean the submissions that we put forward about the forthcoming Immigration Act do make it clear that the aim behind it is to create a more hostile environment, and the underlying principle is if you can go home, you should go home, and you wouldn't be destitute but for that. In terms of the law, I mean, there have been many challenges taking using human rights legislation around about destitution. There have been some successful challenges in that area, and Janice Scott, in her opinion, which is part of the British Red Cross submission, comments on that. What interests me from the perspective of being in Scotland is that a lot of these provisions that do relate to devolved matters are coming from an Immigration Act that is saying it's about immigration, it is reserved, yet its provisions are undoubtedly, when we have a Home Office regulated framework of local authority support, if that comes into play. Now, no consent was obtained about those from Scotland. If those provisions do apply to Scotland, it will come into force through secondary regulations. Now, there's a lack of scrutiny in that. However, there is also the option that if those provisions do create increased destitution and increased risks of families, children being in situations where their human rights are breached, then in Scotland, lawyers could take a challenge to bring down that secondary legislation that has come in on human rights grounds. So we could have the situation in the future that there will be legislation, and I would anticipate that there will be, that would actually strike down some of these provisions within Scotland, yet they cannot be struck down in the rest of the UK. And that's interesting, and that's an interesting position to be in for ILPA, and it's an interesting set of affairs for ILPA as a UK organisation to consider. So there is the option, using human rights and international human rights legislation as well as our national human rights legislation, to potentially strike down some of these provisions within Scotland.
Is there also an offence in terms of the failure to even consider applications? I mean, Mrs. Qureshi raised an example there of 100,000 letters unopened, presumably which were letters of application. I mean, does that fall within international law that a state doesn't even consider applications?
I mean, there are always obligations on the state, including, you know, that be it the Home Office, be it the local authority, to protect and promote human rights. And where there are individual breaches like that, then there may be something that could be done using human rights legislation. The key there, though, is how do you, when bringing it back to destitution, when we have so many people being turned away, when we have such complexity in terms of the processes and the legislation, how do people know, one, what their rights are, two, that there may be a human rights breach in there that could be litigated on, and three, where to go in order to get that specialist advice to hold that authority, whoever they may be, to account. So yes, in principle, that route is there, but in practice, without a clarity of guidance, a clarity of approach and access to services to then, you know, hold those authorities to account, we can have a deficit.
How much of a backdrop of concern to what you do now of our repeal of the Human Rights Act and a potential withdrawal from ECHR, how does that complicate things?
It increases the worry.
Does it take away that right to justice?
Well, it takes away some of the tools in the pot or that a lawyer has in order to assist individuals, in order to hold authorities and governments to account. So yes, it takes away our tools as lawyers in that regard. And certainly, I mean, our members are very worried about the state of affairs as it is. And our members are very clear that with this, you know, with all of these things that you mentioned, that the situation is only going to become worse. And then if our tools are taken away in order to provide that accountability and direct support, then
no recourse to public funds and no recourse to justice. Yeah. Robina, you wanted to come in.
I think I forgot. No, I think I've... Yeah. No, I was just thinking of those 100,000 letters, and I was... The fact that Theresa May presided over that as Home Secretary, I think it was 2012 or 2010, and I'm just wondering how many thousands of letters are lying unopened in Downing Street. So that's just...
Yeah. David.
Thank you. Yeah, I just will say I can send the committee the decision of the European Committee on Social Rights, which was the one that I mentioned earlier. And I've also got a short comment piece from Nils Muesniek, the Commissioner for Human Rights for the Council of Europe. And it talks about these things. So it might just help also give a little bit of context.
We're up against our time. It's general questions this morning, so it's always really tight on a Thursday morning. We try to draw the best and the quickest evidence we can, but we've got lots of excellent written evidence as well. We thank you so much for that. If you go away and you think there's other things you should have told us, please let us know. Our clerks will be in touch with, no doubt, all of you, probably, in continuation of this inquiry. It will continue on. We've made an invitation to the UK Immigration Minister. That's not been accepted, but we're still going to try and push that. So this piece of work will continue on for the next few weeks anyway, and we have more evidence to take. But we want to thank you for coming along this morning. And as I say, if there's anything else that you think would help us, especially if you think along the lines of recommendations, you know, we're looking for sharp, pointed, couple of sentences of this would fix that, that would fix this. We were really, really keen to hear that, so we'd be happy to hear that this morning. But thank you so much for coming this morning. We really appreciate it. Thank you. And I'm going to move the committee into private.